The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily reflect those of Access for Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting groups. If you'd like to produce a show, call us at 260-421-1250.
Hello, this is Patty Hunter of Patty's Page. Today we're doing a very special show with Scott Page. He is a singer and has his own music business, so we'll be with him in a moment, so hang in there. This is Scott Page. Where were you born and raised, sir?
I was born in Los Angeles on a street called Van Nuys Boulevard in the valley. In the San Fernando Valley.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Oh, you're American.
I am American. I'm one of those locals from California.
Right? Ah, California guy.
Yeah.
We lived in Newport Beach, then Trabuco Canyon, and Santa Margarita, you know, that village between Los Angeles. Yeah, we lived there for about 11 years, eh?
Right. Yeah, I was in Newport Beach for about 20 years, back and forth. I had my boat down there, so I was going back and forth between that space.
Oh, down in the marina.
So I know Newport very well. It's very nice down there.
Expensive, though.
Yeah, it sure was.
Still is. While growing up, who influenced you the most? Who mentored you, whatever the word is?
Well, depends. I guess, you know, my dad was a musician, and I started learning to play through him. He got me started when I was young.
Oh, yeah.
He was on a show called The Lawrence Welk Show. Do you remember The Lawrence Welk Show?
We watch it every Saturday in the evening. So what was his name?
My father's name was Bill Page. And he was in the woodwind section, so I grew up on the Lawrence Welk Show for about 14 years. He was in that band.
Wow.
I believe I'll let Scotty do the honors thing.
My name is Scott Page. This is my mother, Lisa, and this is my father, Bill Page.
He was one of my big influences, for sure. Got into music, and then, you know, I've had handfuls of mentors through the years. I don't even know where to start on that. From a composing and arranging point of view, it was a gentleman by the name of Lyle Spud Murphy. I studied his course of composing and arranging and grew, basically graduated from his course. And he was my mentor, not only from a music point of view, but more from a life point of view. Incredible guy, learned a lot from him. I've had so many different guys. Jerome Jumenville was one of my saxophone mentors. He was really the one that got me started playing the saxophone. At the early age, I was more of a trumpet player. But he was the one that got me going, and he was, I was doing a recording session playing trumpet with him in a band called Delaney and Bonnie, and we were doing a record back in the day. Jerome was the tenor player, and he's famous. You know him from bands like he was in Rod Stewart's band for a long time, Dr. John, and varieties of others. He was in Bette Miller, he was in The Rose. Anyway, he's one of my all-time favorite saxophone players. He really got me started because I've never seen anybody love the saxophone more than Jerome. And he was just so infectious hanging out with him, so I went and bought a saxophone and spent the next about 6 months going to his house every day and really studied playing. I have so many mentors, I don't even know where to start when you talk about influence.
It's like
opening specific areas.
It's like opening a Pandora's box here.
Yeah, because I'm going to have business mentors, because I've been, you know, pretty much a serial entrepreneur for quite a few years, and also have the music side of me, so I have a series of them. They're all different, just depending on which area you want to speak about.
So, at what age did you become interested in music?
I started playing when I was about 6 years old. Mm-hmm. My father was doing was actually in the middle of making a television pilot, one of the first television pilots on videotape. Mm. It was called Music Man Take 10, and my father was the clinician for the Kahn Musical Instrument Company, and they sent him all these instruments to use in this television pilot. Uh-huh. And there was a trumpet there. I opened it up, took it out, and that got me started. I saw that, and I wanted one of those, and so became a trumpet player, even though my father was a woodwind player. And then it was later years in college that I then switched from trumpet over to the saxophone.
Wow. So you just know the trumpet and the saxophone, anything else? Or?
I'm a guitar player. Mostly I play saxophone, guitar, and I haven't played trumpet in many years.
So for learning the music business itself, where and when was that when you started to get behind the scenes or learning about the business part of it?
Music. Well, that goes all the way back to, again, when kid, I grew up in the business, so
yes.
I was around it all my life, virtually all my life, because my dad was continued to be a musician. He was NBC staff for many years, and then he was also in the staff orchestra there, and then he was in Barry Manilow's band.
Mm.
So he was out with him for about 7 years, I guess. And so I'd always been around the music business and was in it when I was in high school. I didn't care about being a musician at all. It was really more about being an architect. And I studied drafting and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
I was actually working in a company called Audiodyne at the time as a draftsman. I got in a band with these guys, Jeff Picaro and David Page, who started Toto. We had a kid band.
Toto!
Yeah, we had a kid band called the Merciful Soul Band.
Yeah.
That really got me hooked in the business because I was going to my day job working for Audiodyne and drinking 20 cups of coffee. And then at night I'd go be playing with this band. We'd be playing some gigs. And I realized there were girls at those gigs. So I decided to become a musician. It was much more interesting than being a draftsman.
No doubt.
Doing drawings. So I moved into the music business at that time.
Was it a rough business?
It's a rough business?
Yeah.
Oh, it's a very, well, sure. It's a very, competitive and, interesting business because it's like any business. It's everything's built upon relationships. And, getting into the game in those days, especially, we didn't have any kind of social media or any kind of way of communicating or finding out or searching things. So it was much different model. I mean, we hang out at the music stores and we're down at the musicians union or we play clubs and that's where the interaction was. So it was a lot different than, it was difficult in the sense if you were trying to make it as like kind of a rock star and, if you were really trying to be a band going out because there was, only so many record labels and they basically controlled all the radio. And so it was very expensive to record in those days. So it wasn't easy to become a rock star, but there were more, I would say, you could get paid to play in clubs,
mm-hmm.
You could do some recording sessions and you could make a living. So the difference there was, is I could, play 5, 6, 7 nights a week in clubs and actually pay my house payment and work and stuff and make a living, even though I wasn't necessarily a big time rock star, so to speak. And, then you just kind of maneuver through the world of getting called to play gigs and move yourself up through the ranks by playing with different people. And then you get the lucky call of the draw and somebody finds you. Like I was lucky that I'd gotten a few calls. A few people came in and seen me in some clubs. That's how I got in Supertramp. That was a big deal for me at the time. That really helped my career a lot. Them sort of discovering me in a bar and meeting up with Bob Siebenberg, who was the drummer who would come into the club every night as we played. And I didn't realize he was in a band, and one night he said, hey, why don't you come check out, and we're looking for somebody to come and audition. So I went to audition and got the gig. So rule of thumb is you never know where work and stuff's going to come from these days. It could be anywhere. So I always tell every artist I know, it's about relationships. Do a lot of meetups, get out there and hang out and start meeting people and get into the gang. So that's really how it started for me.
It's like when one door closes, another door opens for you.
That's correct.
That's right. When you were young, learning how to play the trumpet as well as the bat, saxophone?
Yeah.
Yeah. How long did it take for you to learn?
Oh, I mean, you're still learning. You never stop learning.
Oh.
Right? You're constantly learning. I mean, I still practice and I'm still studying. And, you know, you just, the more you play, the more you realize how little you know. You know, you're getting better, sure, but you're also getting wiser and smarter, and you're learning. You're getting more in tune with how the instrument is, and it's a never-ending, you know, study. You never really completely learn. You get to a point where you can work, but you're constantly studying.
So, over the years, you did play with several bands. How about Pink Floyd? I think I read somewhere you played with Pink Floyd?
Yes, that's correct. Yep, I played with Pink Floyd. Great, incredible time in my life. It was a wonderful band to play with, and I, you know, got to tour the world with them and playing some records with them, and, you know, it was really, truly a great honor. And I actually learned so much from that, playing with David Gilmour, because David is probably one of the greatest masters of melody as a guitar player that there is. And he was a big influence on the way I play today, and he taught me quite a lot, actually.
And Britt Floyd.
And who?
Britt Floyd.
Oh, Britt Floyd. Yeah, those are, you know, it's very interesting. Pink Floyd has such a phenomenon of tribute bands that are out there. And there's a band called Britt Floyd that comes into town. They're out on the road. They do about 165 shows a year. And when they come into town, when they're at the Greek Theater, they call me up. And I think that clip you're talking about I saw online is actually from the Greek Theater. Is that the one where I play Money?
You betcha.
Okay, there you go.
There you go.
Sound so much like Floyd. They've really, you know, worked out all the nuances and all the little details of the records. So yes, every once in a while, I still play sometimes with some of these tribute bands, and it's fun. I'm actually going this week. Actually, tomorrow, I'm leaving to go to Texas to play with a band called the Texas Pink Floyd for a 9/11 for a benefit concert for 9/11 victims. And so we're going there to do that.
So, who's the head honcho of all the Britt Floyd, or just Damien Darling, or?
Yeah, Damon Darling, it's his band. He's been running it. They've been doing that roughly, I think he says, for around 20 years.
Wow,
something like that. They've been doing it like 20 years, yeah.
And what is the genre of those bands?
What is it? I'm sorry?
Genre, style.
What style? You know, I think it's rock, you know. It's I guess you would call it ethereal rock and roll, or I don't really know the exact you know, classic rock, I would say, is what it is. It's classic rock. I mean, Pink Floyd, you know, it's considered one of the top five bands of all time.
They have music
with the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, the Who, Led Zeppelin, Pink Floyd, you know, and then you get into, you know, the David Bowie. So it's one of the, maybe top 10 bands of all time that's out there today. It's still going strong, even though the band doesn't play out there that much anymore. Dave Gilmour still has been doing solo tours. Roger Waters has been out doing solo tours. So, it's a continuing brand. It continues to keep going. And I've actually been doing a show here in Los Angeles called, at a place called Wisdom LA, which is in a 360-degree immersive dome. And my company, Think Experience, we're an immersive entertainment company. We've been doing a variety of different types of things, think experiences. And actually, our very first one we've been doing is
it's
a Pink Floyd experience. So we've been doing Pink Floyd with an all-star band in a 360-degree immersive dome. It's pretty cool. Really, really a different way to hear a concert.
Are you the CEO, or do you have partners in the Think Experience?
I am the CEO, but I do have business partners. Yes, I have my business partner that I basically started a few companies with over the last 20-some years. We've been together out of the technology. Most of the companies I've been building or have started have been in the technology space and entertainment. So this one's in the entertainment technology space. But yes, I do have. There's about eight or nine of us totally in the company right now.
What year was Think Experience formed?
Think is relatively new. It's only been in, it's been less than a year. And so we've been in what I call, what the industry calls the MVP stage, the minimal viable product stage. So we've been doing our first, I actually changed that to minimal desirable product, right in the middle of finishing up that test run, which is this Think Floyd experience in this 360 immersive domes, and we're now expanding the company from that. It's all working well, and we're very happy about that.
You have a website.
Yeah, we just have a very simple website. Like I said, we've been pretty much under the radar, kind of getting this thing rolling.
Yeah, it's not finished.
It's thinkexp.co.
.co, okay.
Yep.
Is it a non-profit organization you're with, Think Experience?
No. Think is a for-profit organization, but we have a very, I would call myself a conscious capitalist. I'm a Marx capitalist type of entrepreneur, but I believe that it needs to have a conscious approach to it. So we have a whole giving strategy built into our model. At our shows, we've been, the company or the organization that we're behind, the company that called the Harold Robinson Foundation, and we're actually in the middle of building a music conservatory right now in downtown Watts for the kids and the families down there. It's myself and Flea from the Chili Peppers, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Norwood Fishbone, Stephen Perkins from Jane's Addiction, a whole host of other musicians. So we're working on that. So every show that we do, we raise money on that show for the organization. So we're big on the philanthropy side of things. We believe that it's important to build a model where we can, a we first model. So we, that's kind of what we're doing on that side.
Do you have volunteers helping you in any way?
Well, the organization does more than us. Like we're the company, we supply some, our goal is to raise funds through our endeavors and the things we sell in our shows and all that. We do volunteer and go out and help. Some of the band members, at Christmas time we go out and we, last year we got pulled around on a sort of a pseudo sled behind a police car. And we threw candy out to the kids and, kind of go into the community and help out. We do events down there for the kids. So we do that kind of volunteer work in that sense. So that's a part of how we support besides the funds.
That's cool.
You
help fellow artists. Can you be more elaborate in how you help other artists, like teaching them or mentoring them?
I've been serial entrepreneur. I've been most of my last probably 5-10 years. Last 10 years, I've been focused on trying to really mentor artists, because it's a very tough business for them today when it's, because it's shifted so much. You just can't really sell music anymore. Because it's mostly live streaming and the way they get it on the internet. And most kids today want the music for free. The streaming business has been pretty rough on independent artists. Even though I truly believe this is probably the greatest time in history for the independent artists, because they have access to audience now, and whoever owns the audience wins. And you can do that through, like what we're doing here, a podcast, and through different online ways, through Twitter, Instagram, that you can actually build an audience, build that relationship, and kind of grow your business. So I've focused my last bunch of years is really helping artists to turn their artistry into a business, because I try to explain to them. The first question I ask is to an artist, is this a business or a hobby? And if they say it's a business, then I say, well, your fans are really more like customers, and you need to treat them like customers and figure out how to create value for them to generate revenue.
That's right.
I actually put a courseware piece together that I taught at the University of Southern California 3 years ago called SPACE. And that stands for Story, Plan, Army, Conversion, Education. And SPACE is a kind of a formula that you go through to build your business. Gives you the points and the things that you do need to do and the things that you don't need to do and where to put your focus. So I've been really trying to help artists that way, really think like a startup business. That's a part of what I do on the side. It was part of one of my other businesses, which was called Ignited Network, where we built infrastructure for those artists to be able to build a fan relation, a fan-to-fan relationship, basically.
That was hard to say.
In an area I've been very, very excited about.
Yes. Mm-hmm. You said something about the human spiritual mind and technology, joining them together.
Oh, well, you know, that's an answer. That's actually... the whole spiritual side, you know, the trying to understand who we are, who I am, and how the conscious world works has been something that's been probably my favorite subject for the last 20-some years.
Yeah.
And I just believe that the inward journey is the most important journey that we make. And really applied that to my business, bringing that type of, thinking into it, in the sense, not thinking yet, well, thinking. It's kind of hard to explain.
Yeah.
But yes, I take a very take that very seriously, and even the show that we're building right now, I'm building some elements of how to make people think about who they are, really, at the core, deepest level. You know, because it's very fascinating that science now is through, quantum mechanics, and, are now starting to come together with the spiritual kind of great avatars or great teachings through the years are actually kind of proving what the great avatars, from Buddha to Jesus to Zohar Rosen, of all these guys have been talking about, science is now starting to prove. And it just really starts to make good business, because we take a totally different approach when you start looking at the world from an inward journey and really trying to discover who you are. So that becomes a part of business. That's a big part of the We First model that I try to adhere to. A good friend of mine, Simon Mainwaring, has a company called Be First, and he really hit me to the idea of this conscious capitalistic point of view, where we bring a more conscious point of view into business. So that's really the point of that, where we're at, is bringing that consciousness into the business world we do.
Far out.
Right. Yep.
you're like a pioneer in your new quest in music. That's how I see it.
I love the pioneering spirit. It's something I've been really, it's been part of my kind of DNA. My father not only was a great musician through the years, but he was a serial entrepreneur. When I grew up, I had boat businesses, donut businesses, lighting businesses, reed businesses, and he was one of the, he was part of the, him and another guy were the guy that invented the wah-wah pedal. And which was very important, still to this day, a piece of gear that musicians use. And we had a recording studio back in the days. And so I've been around the whole serial entrepreneur thing for quite a bit of my life. And pioneering has been a very interesting thing. So my dad was pioneering in the music business, starting the first amplified instrument, the wah-wah pedal, all those types of things. And through my kind of period, I probably wanted to things I'm most proud of is I directed and co-produced the world's first interactive cartoon.
Really?
So I've been in the technology space for a long time. That was back in 1990. Actually, I did my first CD-ROM in 1990, and then that well, first cartoon was done in 1992. And that was back in the day when we were running, you know, Windows machines, 386, 25 megahertz, very low power.
Right.
Like these devices we're talking to Don Day. And so I've been a technologist and really trying to pioneer. And kind of that's what makes me excited. It keeps me young to kind of stay in the game and stay on top of what's
going
on.
You're not that old.
Yeah, and so much is going on in technology today. And that's why the company I'm building is Think is really about the immersive entertainment space. It's using every form of technology from AR to, you know, VR, virtual reality, and all these different new technologies. There's shoes you put on now to turn you into a speaker. There's visual mapping. There's 3D audio. So we're exploring using all of those different types of technologies in the live experience, and that's what Think is about. And it follows a thing I did around 26 years ago called the Grand Scientific Musical Theater. And that's where I combined Hollywood and all this technology to create, you know, kind of new live experience. I truly believe that that's the new frontier right now, the new hot area for artists and businesses is the live experience, because we have people now have so much media, they're on their cell phones all day long, and they're looking for something that's more than just watching a video or even seeing a concert. They're looking more to have an experience. So we've been testing that model out on the shows, the 25 shows we've done. They've done very well.
25.
Repeat business. So it's pointed to the fact that we believe that this new immersive entertainment space is really kind of the next place that we're going.
Yep. I think that's about time you had something like that here. And our cats are fighting right now. Don't mind them.
No, your cats are fighting. Oh,
they're five. They're 5 months old, little guys. And they're into each other all
the
time.
Well, you got me early in the morning today. I'm happy to actually drink my Bulletproof.
Ah, good show.
This is the greatest stuff. I don't know if you ever had Bulletproof.
No, I never heard of it.
Oh, yeah, it's great. It's got collagen protein, but it also has brain octane oil and grass bread. Butter, and it's like the greatest stuff. It clears your head up, and I need it right now. You're like, I've been up all night working, and I'm having to talk to you. So thank God.
I'm not putting you to sleep, kiddo.
Helps me get through these days.
Okay, take a wig. Swig, I mean.
Thank you.
We're going to play that little video of Think Experience now, and we'll be right back. Goals or visions for this unique business?
Basically, the goal, kind of mission, is to kind of is to be the kind of leading immersive entertainment company on the planet, where we're bringing all these technology partners in, marrying with Hollywood. And so the idea is to create this playground for technology companies to bring their wares. And we bring the entertainment, we merge it all together to create a unique experience that constantly evolves. So I think it's really about pioneering that and also pioneering the business models of today. A big part of what we're doing with Think is it's really a platform. So we're building the whole live stack of technologies that are there to basically run these types of immersion shows, and then also combining that with our online messaging and media network, which gives us a whole online infrastructure. So it's really about being the kind of the new business model of how entertainment and live entertainment and online interaction kind of come together.
That's cool.
So it's kind of what we're working on right now.
Do you tour?
We just actually got back from Budapest a few weeks ago. We did a played an incredible show there. Actually, one of the top 10 shows I've probably ever done at a place called, it was called the Azzaro Festival, which is very close to kind of like the Eastern Bloc's version of Burning Man. I don't know if you're familiar with Burning Man.
I've heard of that.
Music trance festival. So this was a big trance music festival out in the mountains there in Budapest, about 40,000 people.
Wow.
And we took our Pink Floyd show and mashed it with a very leading edge EDM artist, electronic music artist, and we did a very interesting show mashing those two genres together. It was fantastic.
I would love to see
that. So I'm touring. I'm leaving tomorrow. I'm going to Texas to work some shows. I don't tour like I used to tour, though. I was on the road every year for 6 months for, 20 years or something
after
like that. So I had my share of touring a lot. So I tour a little bit. I go over to Italy a bit, do some shows there. I was at Canary Islands last year. So I get a little bit of touring in. I'm probably going to do more now with our Think Boy. Some of the things that we're doing there, we'll do some more. Yep.
Well, Britt Floyd came here about four times?
I'm sorry?
Britt Floyd comes here every 2 years.
I played with them about 3 or 4 times here. They've become good friends of mine. So usually when they're in town and stuff, they'll call me up and I'll go play with them. So yeah, they're great. Great band, great people. Incredible.
I wish you could.
If anybody gets a chance to go see their show, if you're a Floyd fan, definitely go see it.
I interviewed Damien twice and then another one, Eduardo Scardo.
Oh yeah, Eduardo, yeah, great guitar player. Oh,
cute too.
And he's really figured out Dave Gilmore and his sound and the way he plays. Because Britt Floyd tries to be very authentic to the original. You know, our Think Floyd, we're different. We're one more of an interpretation of the music. We want to add our own spin to it. So we don't try to do it exactly like the record. We do it with our own little thing.
So, what would you like to share with my audience, especially about succeeding in the music business?
Well, I think that what I'll share real quick is just the overview of SPACE. My that acronym, like I said earlier, stands for Story, Plan, Army, Conversion, Education.
Mm-hmm.
I think the most important thing for an artist today, an independent artist, is you really have to start thinking like a business person.
Yes.
The days are over of where you can just, play your music. Well, I wouldn't say they're over, but it's very difficult to rise above the noise. There's so much music and so many bands out there, and every day people are telling, give me albums. Now that you have tools like GarageBand and varieties of other technology tools, everybody with a laptop can be in the recording business now.
Yeah.
So it's definitely crowded the field. So it's really important that you learn how to be a business and you start using social media things to learn how to build audience. I mean, that's one of the great things right now is we have the tool sets to really build a business. So for artists, it's really important, I think, to think of your art and business in the same frame. So the concept of art, the art of business, is just like the art of music. And the SPACE formula goes story, and the reason I say the story is story is the most critical piece. Because once I know the story, and that story can't be from an artist's point of view today that I play guitar and I live in Cincinnati, I smoke fatties, I write songs. It can't be that. It can't be that. It has to be like, what is your purpose? What do you stand for? What are you trying to do? Because, part of your story is, what do you care about? What value can you bring? And I ask artists, what problem are you solving? Which is a standard question you'd ask any business that is going into business. And most artists would say, I don't understand what you mean, solve a problem. Well, what I'm suggesting to artists is that they find something that they can, that they care about, they're passionate about, and that may be a charity or an organization or some problem solving, solving the reduction of plastics if you're into that, something that you can attach yourself to that you care about, that you do beside your music, and you become part of your story. Because once you have that data, I can now use the technology, since we have access to it, to go find your audience. So I can use those keywords and phrases from that story and find other people to care about that, and then begin to start building relations through that, through social media, with those types of groups and organizations, and start to build my audience. Because the important thing that I'll tell any artist today is whoever owns the audience wins.
Yes.
And the beautiful part about today is you have access to audience now, because you've got Twitter, which I call a 24-hour cocktail party. You've got all the different social medias. You can start building those audience, finding your audience within that story. So that's a critical piece. And then in the space analogy, so story plan, I recommend there's a movement called the Lean Startup Principles, and there's a movement around Lean Startup. All the companies out of Silicon Valley now, or not a lot of the companies, but are using this process, build, measure, learn. So the idea is you build the smallest thing you can, and then you test and validate that to make sure that there's it's valuable. Once you get strong signals that there's actually a market for what you're doing, then you pour gas on it. So the plan is really important, is putting a strategy together, and I recommend using the Lean Canvas. And you can look this up on Google.
Right.
Lean Canvas is a one-page business plan. And that one-page business plan, I run every artist through, because it makes them think through all the issues. And one important part of the one-page business plan is that it teaches you not only what you're going to do, but it teaches you what you're not going to do. Because so many times, people spend a whole lot of time on things that aren't going to really get them the value that they need to bang for their buck. Because in the Lean Startup Principle world, the idea is what's the smallest thing you can do that's going to give you the biggest bang for your buck, and you're not going to run out of resources. So you're balancing, testing, and validating everything beforehand. And it works. The same principles work great with artists in the same way. So anyway, I teach the plan part of it, and then the A part, which is army in my model. And what I mean by that is are the core influencers that are around you, plus your super fans that you have right now. That group of people are your core when you're building your business, because the idea is you want to build your team. And so most artists don't realize that a lot of they don't even really get to know their super fans that well, and don't realize that those super fans a lot of times have skills that can be very valuable for them. And they're such super fans, they'll come and help you out without necessarily having to spend a lot of money. And you can work out ways that you can give the fans an experience and things for helping you out. So army is really critical, because we also know that the revenue from any business or artist comes in. The super fans are your main driver of revenue. We know now that the 1-3% of your entire audience that you have, which are your super fans, will generate roughly 60% or more of your revenue. So it's that small 2-3% of your fan base is really where the money is. So how do I build the relationship, create value for them? So that's the army piece, is figuring that out. And then the next, the C, is it's called conversion. And what I mean by that is once you find and you have some artists, there's a thing called conversion funnels. And conversion funnels, the idea is when I meet someone, how do I eventually build the relationship to business, basically, the funnel is. How do I get them to buy my product or sign up for my offer? So there's a whole process of the funnel. You first meet the person. Once they meet them, they'll maybe get an email from you that then gives them another offer. And it keeps them moving through a funnel so that you're building trust and relationship until you are actually able to sell the services or the music that you're trying to build, or get them to come to your shows or whatever. So conversion is really important to learn. And it's a well-defined process now that you can just learn by the greatest tool that's out there for learning. Just type into Google anything, a phrase, and it will teach you. So I suggest that you go out and look and read conversion funnels, because they're well-defined now and can explain to you exactly how you need to use them and work with them in order to build your fan base and turn them into paying customers. Because there's also a thing called the 1,000 True Fans. It's been around for a while. It's coined by Kevin Kelly from Wired Magazine back in the day. And the 1,000 True Fan model is this. A true fan is somebody that will spend $100 on you a year. Mm. If I have 1,000 true fans, there's my first $100,000 in revenue.
That's right.
So the idea is to go small, build a repeatable model around a small group of people. Once you know that that's working, then you scale. Mm. So it's really using lean startup principles and these ideas of 1,000 true fans to build a business. The goal is, let's go, instead of trying to, you know, sell my music to the entire world, let's go find 1,000 people that care enough about me that will spend $100 a year on me. And that will generate that first $100,000 in revenue, which then I can use to start growing my business and scale from there. And then the last in the space model is the E. And E is the important one. That stands for education.
Right.
Everything I just explained to you up on top,
you're a good
teacher.
It's not going
to work unless you get educated. You have to get educated, and that's really where you use Google. And I always tell the people that I mentor, I work with the artists that I help with their careers, is they got to spend a couple hours every morning reading, getting up to speed, following the right influencers and people that can really help them learn their business. Again, it's like, yeah, I use social media, but why don't you type into Google how to use Twitter for business and learn business tactics on how to use these tools, Instagram, Facebook, all of those types of things. So that's kind of my space model, and that would be my
wow.
for the artists today on what they need to go do. So there's a little advice from me again, that, and I've seen this model work, and I know it does work. It's work.
Yeah.
it's not easy.
That's right.
But it is possible, and that's the beauty of today, is with direct access to audience through using your cell phones.
Right.
Your cell phone's a global broadcast network. It's video, it's audio, you have the power of what television stations had in their hands, 10, 15 years ago, that only few had. You have that now.
Yeah.
So now it's really to get educated on how to use this stuff and obviously get up to speed on technology, understand how algorithms work. And that's the education that I believe all artists need to start doing. And the good news is you can get educated online.
I have one question left.
Sure.
Royalties.
Yeah. What about them?
Well, if your stuff is being played on computers and iPads, how are you going to get royalties
the royalties are rough today. That's the big part, the tracking of those and even getting played. So that's why the new model, it's like, what can you sell today as an artist? You can't sell music anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, you can get some royalties. You'll get royalties if you get your music into, movies or films or television. Like that, there's those types of royalties, and obviously if you get radio play, which is difficult. If you can get on this, playlist, like the Spotify playlist, which are the new radio stations, but those are pretty much controlled by the record labels who actually own all the streaming networks. So what artists really sell today, and where the money really is on two things: the experience, what experience we sell, and the relationship, the lifestyle. So that's the whole idea of what you sell is what people are. If you're an artist and you have fans, they're interested in what you're doing, what's your story, what value. And then you got to think about unique ways to bundle your experiences and your shows to make it more worthwhile to show up. So the money's really in the relationship and the experiences you deliver for your fans today. Royalties, they come when they're there, but again, it's a little more difficult to get and track. But
yeah,
there are some services out there that are now starting to track. If you tag your music properly before you, or the content you put it up, they can start tracking it. And there are some royalties to be paid, but it's definitely a problem. It's working on being solved, for sure.
I hope so. So this is towards the end of the show. Thank you for coming to my show. So this is Patty Hunter on Patty's Page. We had Scott Page as our guest. And he was very, very educational. So thank you, and we'll see you next week.
Godspeed, my love, until we meet again. You're always in my heart and every dream. Don't let this time apart give in to all our fears. God will keep close from up above. So until we meet again, Godspeed, my love. with us always for the rest of our lives.